This is the BBC.
This podcast is supported by advertising outside the UK.
Everyone likes shopping online, but searching for coupon codes is kind of a bummer. So make saving online a breeze with Capital One Shopping. Capital One Shopping is a free tool that instantly searches for available coupon codes and automatically applies them at checkout. Just download Capital One Shopping to your computer and let it do the work for you. So easy, and you don't even need a Capital One card to use it. Capital One Shopping, it's kind of genius. What's in your wallet? Savings and available coupons vary.
Hello and welcome to the podcast for Gardener's Corner on BBC Radio Ulster.
Gardener's Corner with David Maxwell on BBC Radio Ulster and BBC Sounds.
Hello and welcome to the programme. This week I'm visiting three gardens in County Donegal. Glenveagh Castle's lush and formal gardens stand out in their remote and rugged mountain setting. And Cluanadore on North Donegal's wild Atlantic coast is full to bursting with unusual plants from around the world. But we start this week's programme on the shores of Mulroy Bay, catching up with a much-missed friend. Well, I've just walked into the beautiful courtyard garden of Brendan Little. Brendan, it is so nice to be back in your garden and nice to see you again.
Thanks very much, David. Yeah, I must say this is slightly emotional for me because, you know, I suppose it's been no secret, you know, for people who know me that I've had some health issues in the past. I had cancer maybe 4 years ago, had surgery, and unfortunately it resurfaced about 6 months ago. So I spent a lot of the summer having radiotherapy treatment, which seems to have done the trick. And when you've cancer the first time, you feel, OK, this is bad luck for me, you have the treatment. You don't feel you deserve to have a recurrence. So it is a bit of a shattering blow when it does recur. But listen, that is life, and there's no shame in having something like cancer.
You've been through the treatment, which I know can be difficult to go through, but we are sitting today in what is your beautiful courtyard garden. Even though you've been going through all of that, you've kept this place looking pretty good, Brendan.
I think I'm so lucky to have a garden, and I really appreciate having the space. And I just felt, okay, you can sit back and feel sorry for yourself, or you can just get up and start doing things. So I kind of gave myself a couple of different projects and I built a little lean-to. I felt too with the whole pandemic thing that we're going to be spending more time maybe dining out of doors when people come to visit. So I wanted a courtyard that would be very welcoming, that would be very healthy, we would have good air circulation. So that kind of kept me busy, and we love this space. I would also think, you know, you don't need a huge space to make it hospitable, to make it a nice space to sit out and enjoy. And I kind of have been trying to do that all summer, just create a space where I would enjoy sitting out. I think it's very important too, for me it's very important, that when you are unwell and you're getting treatment, that your spirits can wane a bit, as can your energy levels. And the garden does tend to get away from you. And it's so important to say to yourself, well, actually, I will catch up slowly but surely. So I've allowed more and more of my garden revert to nature. The rewards has been bird song. In days gone by, people had parts of the fields where the machines couldn't go and they called it Hare's Corner. And I have a lot of Hare's Corners in my garden. But the beauty, this morning I looked out and there were two hares on the gravel. So, you know, when your garden starts getting away from you, don't see it as getting away from you. Enjoy it. Reduce the area that you manicure. Let nature reign supreme in other parts, and the rewards will be birdsong, butterflies, bumblebees, honeybees, foxes, hares, whatever. So don't get down if your garden's getting away, just downsize.
Here we are in September, and yet this courtyard area at the back of the house is full of flowers, Brendan. One which I have to mention, which has really taken my fancy, is Nicotiana, the tobacco plant, tobacco flower. And there's a little white one you have here on the back of the bell-shaped flower. There's also kind of a lime green colour. And you've planted it, well, I say en masse, you know, it's in a lot of pots here and it is still flowering strong.
Yeah, well, I just enjoy growing annuals. I think they give you great, I suppose, field to an area like this. And you look around here and you think, oh, this looks nicely organized. This is really a mishmash, David. These are just plants I grew from seed. I have sweet peas. I have cosmos, which I really love. Yeah, the Koshiana is one called Starlight. Simply a packet of seeds, sow them, prick them out, potted them up. And
so cheap as well.
Oh, cheap and cheerful. I mean, what a value plant. And it has gone on and on and on this summer. So annuals, I think we tend to ignore annuals or not give them the credit they deserve. There's a wonderful range of annuals. They are cheap. You produce a multitude of plants for very little investment, and they will reward you all summer. And they are great for big splashes in this little courtyard area. And I think they should get a lot more attention than they do.
We're sitting at a little bistro table here as well, and I can see that there are some bulbs on the table here, so already planning ahead. Isn't that a nice aspect of gardening as well, that you're looking ahead to the future, particularly given the time that you've had, that you're sitting down now and you're looking at just the top packet here is Fritillaria, Uva vulpis, and obviously there are plans in place to begin making for a spring garden.
Well, I love spring flowering bulbs, and now is the time to start preparing. Now they are appearing in the shops, but I love snowdrops, crocus, the imperial Fritillaria, Fritillaria imperialis. I love the alliums. So I'm buying bulbs. I think my favourite daffodil is Tete Tete. I also like Bulbocodium. I like the small ones. And now is the time to prepare. And I'm going to naturalise these plants, these bulbs, let them pop up through my lawn, and they will give me a nice spring flash. They will reduce my mowing regime. And I'm going to garden more and more with nature. The older I get, the more of the legacy I want to leave is a good habitat, an environmental space, a space for biodiversity rather than a manicured garden. So maybe I'm getting lazy, but that's the route I am going to take as time goes on.
This is a place to kind of entertain friends, to spend time with family. It's a very social space.
Yes, it is. We have lots of seating areas in the garden. And we, as you say, we have lots of seating in this little courtyard. I think you don't need to break the bank too when it comes to seating. A little bit of imagination will give you good little sitting spaces. So don't feel you need a deep pocket if you've got a little town garden, a little small space. With a little bit of your using your imagination, watch what other people have done. And very quickly, you can create a nice, intimate sitting space. As I say, this is not rocket science. The pots are higgledy-piggledy all over the place. So a parasol, or if you can get the old sail of a boat to make a little cover, use your imagination. I don't want to be in the sun all the time, so I do enjoy sitting in the shade from time to time. And these shady spaces, have your seats in the sun, have your seats in the shade, have your seats in dappled shade. Make sure you have lots of nice spaces for you to sit and enjoy the garden.
Well, this is a lovely garden to spend time in. We're not going to see all of the rest of the garden here today, because seeing this courtyard is treat enough. And if you needed some inspiration, you don't have to go very far in Donegal, do you? Of course, many people will have heard of the Donegal Garden Trail. And we're going to go to a couple of the gardens today which find a place on that trail. And our first stop is Glenveagh.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by.
Well, it's a beautiful still day, and I've made my way to Glenveagh, and Glenveagh Castle is sitting just below me here. I'm in the walled garden at the moment. I'm with the head gardener here, Sean O'Guihan. For those who don't know Glenveagh, maybe you could give a very quick kind of potted history of how this place came to be.
Well, the lands were bought by this gentleman called John George Adair. He was from what used to be called Queen's County, now County Leash. And he was a property speculator, basically. And he bought up all these separate estates or tracts of land, really to form this kind of large hunting estate in that really takes in the entire valley of Glenveagh. So that's the original act. And that was in the late 1850s, 1857, 1858, he bought the lands. And then about 10 years later, he married a quite wealthy American heiress in 1867. And really after they got married, this castle was built. And it had a couple of different phases, the castle, but the initial phase was as a kind of a hunting lodge modelled on an old Irish castle with a tall rectangular keep and an adjoining wing. And it was developed originally as a sport hunting estate.
And it has developed over the years since then. But one of the things that really stands out when you approach this place, Sean, is that essentially you're kind of coming over the hills, you're seeing kind of a lot of scrubland, and then Glenveagh stands out because one of the first things they must have done here is planted trees.
Most of the trees that we have in the garden were all planted, we think, in the 1890s. The planting started here in the 1860s and continued right into the 20th century. So we now have quite a good amount of Scots pine plantation around the castle and also in different points in the park.
I suppose the thing is, initially it was designed, as you say, as a hunting lodge. A little bit later, bits were added and it became, I don't know, more of a holiday home or somewhere that was a slightly more permanent residence. And once you had that back in those days, you needed a walled garden, didn't you? Because you couldn't just pop down to the local shop.
And we believe the walled garden occupies the location where the quarry was, where the stone was taken out of the side of the hill to build the castle. And then once the castle had been constructed, soil was carted in. And like all these plots, we have six plots in the walled garden and they're a metre deep of topsoil. So there's a fantastic amount of really good topsoil in this. That was all carted in. The tradition has it that all the locals, they sold their soil to Glenveagh at a penny a cartload.
So it was good soil that had been worked.
It was all, people were selling their gardens to Glenveagh, you know, what it had built up in their gardens over the years. So, and it's the same in the pleasure grounds. All the soil there, hundreds of tons of soil was brought in to make up these gardens.
Who was most responsible in the history of this place for the gardens that we see today?
Well, really, it was Mrs. Adair. Cornelia Adair was her name, this American woman who embraced life here, particularly in the British Empire at the time. And she became really very, very close and beloved to the British establishment. She was entertaining royalty both here in Glenveagh and in her London home in Grosvenor Square. But she had a profound influence on the place. It was she that started the gardens. She doubled the size of the castle. She introduced red deer. She had a fence put around the estate, a 45-kilometre fence to contain the red deer herd. So really all the major cultural imprints that happened here in the 19th century, we still have them here today. And the same dynamics that she introduced in the 19th century, we still actually have those same dynamics going on to this day. So actually, you know, the downside is there's now too many deer and we have a big problem with the rhododendrons. Both of those things were, you know, she introduced.
I always love being in a walled garden. I think they have a very kind of special atmosphere. And I suppose at the start I mentioned the trees as well. So you have trees all around us, creating a bit of a shelter belt, I suppose. We have this wall around the garden itself. What is this space like to work in and to garden, Sean?
Oh, I think for most people who come and experience Glenveagh, the walled garden really is the most magical part of the place. It has this unbelievable charm and it is remarkably sheltered. So it's in a hollow, And then we have trees surrounding it. So even on a windy day, it's incredibly calm and sheltered. And so it really makes the best of the conditions that are here. And then we've stocked it with a lot of things like Irish apples. So all the fruit trees you see, all these larger fruit trees, they're all old Irish apple varieties. So we're very interested in growing and displaying cultural heritage stuff that's relevant to Ireland. We have a cabbage that's unique to Donegal, the Gortahar cabbage. We have the Mat Armour Dahlia, which is unique to Glenveagh. That was originally introduced here in 1930. So we've had that now for over 90 years at this stage.
That's a single red flower, so isn't it?
We've been planting and lifting and planting and lifting that plant for over 90 years. So it's a single red dahlia. It's known in the species as Dahlia coccinea, and it's actually what you would find in the wild. And they believe it's also what the Aztecs actually grew as a vegetable. Mm. And seed of this dahlia was given to Mat Armour when he was a young gardener here in 1930, and we've had it here ever since. So it's been named for Mat because it was really his dahlia, he grew it.
So those plants that are important to Ireland find a place here at Glenveagh. We're starting at what I think was the gardener's cottage. You used to live here, I think.
Yeah, so Mrs. Adair would have had this built for... It's as good as evidence as any that she wanted a garden. She built a gardener's house, you know, for a gardener to live in. It has always been occupied by the different gardeners over the years. So I got to live here for about 10 years. We now have, I have my own place now on the coast where it's kind of, there's no midges. But like we now use the cottage as an archive facility. So all the historical stuff relating to the garden and generally to Glenveagh, we're storing in the cottage, and we can bring people in on an individual basis and make the information available. It's not actually open to the public, the cottage, but it's a great way of using the building and preserving it as part of the infrastructure of the garden.
Before we started recording, you showed me a little plant which is just at the front of the cottage here. It finds its place in a broken terracotta pot, which I imagine has been in the garden here for quite a while. And you said to me, this is a pretty rare plant.
Yeah, well, I refer to it as, you know, the rarest plant we have in Ireland. And it's called Helianthemum nummularium. It's the rock rose, right?
So it's very low growing, just to describe, first of all, simple green leaves, but very low growing and kind of a sprawling habit.
Yeah, like a little sprawling alpine with gorgeous yellow flowers. And it flowers in June. It only occurs in one place in Ireland, and it's in Donegal, in South Donegal, and its location is kept secret because it is so rare. And it's a bit of a mystery how, and you know, it's in its right habitat. You know, there's a lot of helianthemum on limey soils in the south of England, but this is the only location in Ireland for it. So it is extraordinarily rare. They're doing DNA work on it in the Botanic Gardens at the moment in Dublin to try and determine where it came from and what it's related to. But it is actually an extremely rare plant, and we can do things like, yeah, I have it in the pot here because the soil in the pot matches the plant. It's kind of a limey soil. If I had that planted out in the garden here in Glenveagh, we could get swamped quite quickly by weeds, and all our soil is a bit on the acid side as well.
Well, you've mentioned the garden. We can see it. It's enticing to look down on. Let's head down there and have a further look. Right, so we've just stepped into the garden, Sean, here. As with many walled gardens, there are lots and lots of beds. Where have we come to first, and what are we looking at growing here? Because I suppose you might expect to see vegetables or flowers, but actually I think I'm looking at some trees here.
Yeah, they're lined out. That's actually 1,000 seedling Scots pine. Scots pine, you can tell them because they have this kind of blue-green foliage. That's one of the ways you can distinguish Scots pine from other kinds of pine. It has this lovely blue-green foliage, and then as it matures, it has this very nice red bark. You can see the mature trees beside the castle have this lovely orangey-red bark. So anyway, these particular seedling pine come from a nursery where they were grown, and these are all actually sourced from what is believed to be native Irish pine. So for a long number of years, really for centuries, botanists have assumed that Scots pine actually died out in Ireland, and that all the pine as we see them today are actually introduced from Scotland. They've now come up with pretty convincing evidence that some of the older populations of pine did survive in the west of Ireland, and there's one particular location in the Burren National Park in County Clare, where they've done DNA work and they've also done pollen sampling, and they've discovered that really these pine really appear to be indigenous, and so seed has been collected from them, and that's what these trees have come from, the seed from those trees. So we're actually planning a large conservation plantation of these trees, up to maybe 3,000 of these trees, in a location in the lower part of the park where we can conserve these stock, and then like in 50 years' time they'll be a seed source for new generations of Scots pine that are kind of, we're helping to conserve and to stabilise the conservation of that particular extremely rare native plant.
So these should, potentially, these should be called Irish pine. They're growing well here, yeah, and they're going to find a home on this estate.
Yeah, yeah. There's some evidence to suggest that the Scots pine that are growing in Ireland, if it, you know, there's still work going on, but if it is the case, if they can really definitively say this is actually the case, it would indicate that the Scots pine that we have are descended from a very ancient stock. And they say that the stock that grew in Ireland, the Scots pine in Scotland actually are descended from. So, you know, you could say that they should be called Irish pine and not Scots pine. It's kind of only a funny thing. The actual Latin name is Pinus sylvestris, and it's one of the most common of pines in the whole Northern Hemisphere. At this time of year, here we are in mid-September, and people are going, what's that? You know, because people are so used to seeing crocuses in the spring, and then they forget that you can have crocuses in the autumn. So this is the autumn crocus.
And it comes up without any leaves. And
yeah, all the foliage grows in the spring. So it's an absolute mass of foliage in the springtime. And then it just pops up as this gorgeous naked flower. They're really quite extraordinary looking. They're only starting to flower now. They'll be by next week, there'll be an absolute mass of them. And actually, you know, this is one of the situations where, like, I had a couple of transition year students here in the garden. And it's a perfect little project for, like, say, if you have two or three young people and to give them one job to do. I had one clump of autumn crocus, and I said, divide that up and just plant them all out individually all along here in a particular part of the garden. And so by just taking one small clump, we've now got masses of the things. And the box curlicues, I bought them. We were shipping a few things. I think, what was it? We bought various things from Italy about 10 years ago. And there was an opportunity to buy these curlicues. We have ancient examples of these spirals of box. And I bought replacements so that when the older ones just get too old and raggedy, we can take them out and we can put in these new ones. So we're always, one of the great things about working in a place like this is we think about 10 years ahead. Mm. You know, we're looking ahead all the time at how we can conserve the character of the place. And things we do now will influence things in the future, like in 10 years' time.
And has box blight stayed away from Glenveagh?
No, it hasn't. It's arrived.
Has it?
Yes. So
how are you coping with that?
Well, there's nothing you can do about it, really. You can. I was talking to a fellow gardener who has been battling with it in East Donegal, and nothing works. Ultimately, the box may have to be taken out and replaced with something else, evergreen.
Yeah, I agree with Sean. I have box blight at home. number of large box domes, which were my babies, but the ones actually in the most exposed places are starting to show signs of box blight. I did spray with a fungicide last year and it seemed to kind of ward it off for a while, but you don't want to go down the route, I certainly don't want to go down the road of using chemicals constantly. I think, as Sean says, if box blight is here, we may just need to use alternative plants.
What good alternatives are there, Brendan, to box? What would you recommend?
I like Teucrium. I think it's a good replacement. And I think there's a genus that is seldom used and deserves much more attention are the filarias. Filaria latifolia, Filaria angustifolia. I just remember being in Glasnevin as a student before Sean. Sean's much younger than me. And I just thought there were two glorious hedges of filaria there. So they might be two species, or that's a genus I would like to try as a replacement.
So what is the main work, Sean, going on here at Glenveagh at the moment in the garden as we kind of approach, I say approach autumn tentatively, because sure. As I look round, I mean, the trees are still green, right? There's very few signs of autumn here.
Sure, we're already thinking about next year's garden. So it's always the case, come September, whatever we start doing now will influence next year's garden. So we're clearing, we're weeding, we're composting, we're getting ready to do our winter dig, which will mean when come the spring there'll be fertility and drainage and all the rest of it, and we'll be able to do our planting the following year. In another, we usually by October we'll see the odd frosty night, and that's after that then we'll be lifting all the dahlias, storing them in boxes over winter and having them for the spring. So there's actually a lot of work happens. There's a big, huge tidy up, and we try to have the wall garden especially neat and tidy before Christmas. So there's a whole cutting back all the herbaceous borders will be another thing that we'll do now later on in October, November. So there's quite a lot of putting to bed in the garden. One of the really nice things about the garden is actually these native woodlands. So we're in the native woodlands here. You see, these are all fascicularias flowering at the moment. So fascicularias are from Central America.
Yes, these are exotic looking. You say native woodland, but all of a sudden you look down and you see these kind of strappy, sharp-end leaves. And then some of the leaves in the middle are red. And then what's going on in the middle there?
Yeah, well, it's related to the pineapple and to the air plants. So it doesn't actually need a whole lot of soil. And it's from Central America, this thing. And when it's going to flower in the autumn, all the central leaves, they turn red. And then you get this disc of blue flowers at the centre of the rosette.
It's extraordinary. There's blue, beautiful. There's little bits of yellow in the middle, and then this kind of violet colour almost. Yeah. Just so very exotic looking.
It is. And for, again, here we are in mid-September. It's really wonderful to have something as exotic as this to delight the eye. So we have this wonderful combination of the biodiversity of nature and the introduced biodiversity of the garden. So that's another thing that really sets the garden apart. Like, who has that?
Not a bad day. Nice day.
Lovely, isn't it? Yeah.
This is pure native woodland. Look, there's the yew tree. That's a native yew. And then this is one of the seats, one of the Mrs. Adair seats. And in her time, there was probably less trees.
Yes.
And you would be looking straight across at the castle just there. But what we actually have here is a garden entirely made up of native species.
Oh, what I love about where we're standing now is green is such a good colour, and it's an underrated colour. People want to see splashes of bright, blousy flowers, and they are fine in the right place. But sometimes green is just enough. The woodrush, the hollies, the berries on the hollies, the oaks, the sorbers, the mountain ashes are carrying berries also. So sometimes a little is more. And as Sean once told me long, long ago, and I've often quoted him, it's very important to know when to stop gardening. You can overgarden a space and lose the whole field that you set out to create.
Well, Sean, thank you so much for showing us around the beautiful grounds of Glenveagh, which are open to the public 365 days a year. You can't argue with that. Well, we're going to get into the car now, travel for about half an hour to another favourite garden, another garden which finds its place on the Donegal Garden Trail in Falkara.
Who can say where the road goes, where the day flows, only time and
Well, after what I think is about 3 years, I've made my way back to Clúnadóir, absolutely one of my favourite places to be in Ireland, a beautiful garden, only about 10 minutes walk from the sea. Seamus O'Donnell is with me. Seamus, good to see you again. Good to be in this garden again. And we're starting today at a most extraordinary plant, which is towering above us here. I'm not sure whether I describe it as a shrub or a tree, but it appears to have these almost large catkins falling down towards us here. What is it?
David, that is a Buddleia forestii, and probably only 6-7 years old.
Really?
Given to me as a cutting. And now it's very unusual because of its size and because of the flower. The flower heads are weeping rather than upright. So it's just a buzz. It's terrific for the pollinators, you know.
And for those who don't know the garden, Seamus, you would get wind here, you would get rain, of course, but quite mild.
No, that we have plenty of wind, but no frost as such, you know. So we're blessed in that sense. So I suppose I've established shelter here now, and because of the shelter, I can grow all these exotic plants.
It is just so beautiful. Brendan Little's also with me. Brendan, I know it caught your eye.
It's the most stunning plant. I thought from a distance it looked like the wingnut tree, but when you come up close, you realise that these are not catkins, and these are the most beautiful catkin-like seed heads. But there are a few flowers still visible. I think it's just a stunning plant. It's just absolutely gorgeous. Your normal Buddleia leaf, but these wonderful, wonderful catkins. And as Seamus says, it holds the flowers in the downward position. They weep downwards. And I love plants that have a weeping growth habit, or if the flowers are weeping. They just have a lovely, lovely, gentle elegance. And by golly, it is a gentle, elegant plant. And Seamus, do the butterflies love it?
Ah, oh, they do. And the bumblebees especially, beautiful, you know. Beautiful. I think this has been a super year for bumblebees.
It has been a super year for bumblebees, yeah.
No, it's just you're sort of juking, getting out of their way. They're just flying by.
Something that you have a fair number of in the garden is eucalyptus. We're looking at one here now, 15, 20 feet, something like that. You're keeping them quite low?
No, I have to do that. As peaty ground we're on here, so it's to prevent root rock. So I suppose it'd get top heavy and it would tumble over. So I just make a point of cutting them back once a year in the autumn time. But, you know, sometimes I leave some of the branches go so it's not losing its height. But then they're getting stronger every year, in other words. And eventually I'll not bother cutting them back. And there's the foliage. Deserves to be closer to the ground to be admired.
Yeah, so that's the danger with them. They grow very fast, Brendan, these plants.
It's always a bit of a worry when a plant really takes off, because you really don't know how well the roots are doing below ground. You can see it's producing a lovely canopy, but if the roots are not expanding or growing at the same rate, it's going to become top heavy. So it is kind of a word of warning with plants that grow particularly fast, that you may not have as much root below ground as you would like to keep the plant balanced. And yes, I mean, quite rightly, Seamus is pruning the head to allow the roots to expand, and then in the hope that when they are fully developed, they will be able to support a bigger canopy. But I love the fact that he's cutting it back, because we now have beautiful fragrant foliage at head height. And so you can use your senses as you walk through this garden. You can crush foliage, and I think that adds a whole another dimension to a garden. If you have foliage that gives off a nice fragrance, ideally if it's at eye or nose level, you're on a winner.
David, now we're amongst the birch trees, and I adore birch trees. I think they're such a beautiful tree. And what I have done is I've raised the crown, and I usually cut the branches in November, because if you do it at any other stage, especially springtime, there's too much sap rising. So November is always the best time to prune your birch trees. But by doing that, then you can see the way you can see the rest of the garden now by just looking through the stems of the birch trees. Mm. But then it allows you to grow a lot more underneath them. So now it's an interesting way to garden, I think, to raise the crown as much as possible just to get the light in there. I'm doing the same here behind us now with Amelanchier here. So I'm raising the crown of that as well. And then that allows light, so I have a lot of Hemerocallis planted underneath that. So otherwise I wouldn't be able to plant the hemerocalls. It'd be too dark for them.
Yeah, I've noticed walking around, Seamus, you're not afraid to cut things back, to shape things if necessary. I mean, it feels very kind of organic and natural, but every now and again, you get a little something that you've decided, I'm going to clip that. Just a minute ago there, we saw some of those evergreen oaks, the home oak, almost kind of clipped as mushrooms.
Yeah, or flying saucers or whatever you wish they can be. No, I get a great satisfaction out of being able to prune, and it's just immediate, you know. So if it's a bit unruly and then you get a bit of shape on it, you know, there's nothing like it. You just stand back and you know, it's a case of admiring one's work, you know.
It stands out, Brendan, doesn't it? Because it kind of interests the eye, because you have all of these natural forms, things taking their own path, and then all of a sudden something that's been clipped, something that's been formalised.
I think, you know, what I sense from Seamus too is it's good fun, and gardening should be fun. And if you're not enjoying it, you're getting it wrong. So I think, first of all, people with a small town garden, that is something you can do, is to shape plants. Very few plants died because they were pruned. In fact, most plants, woody plants that we prune, will come back with a vengeance when you prune them, so you'll actually be doing them a big favour. I love the crown raising, because if you have a small space and you crown raise, you now double the space because you can plant underneath with bulbs, with perennials, with grasses. So if you are challenged spatially, shall we say, you can still visit large gardens and take, you know, get examples, good little cameos that you can use in your space. And removing or the lower branches opens up a whole space. If you're losing a lot of your garden to darkness because plants are overshadowing others, you're really just limiting the space. So crown raising works really well.
And from a practical point of view, Brendan, once you do that, say you had a birch tree in your garden, like this one behind you, which is absolutely towering above us, it's very, very tall, and you raise the crown, you create this space, this light really around the bottom. Is it possible to just start planting? Would you need to do anything to the soil around it to help those plants to get established? What would your advice be?
Okay, ideally, the older a plant is, the more established its root system is going to be, and the more challenging it is going to be to establish other plants underneath. But if you are sensitive and you dig out your planting pits and you incorporate organic matter, and I think for the first season or two, irrigation is very important. That if we had anything like a period of drought, the big tree is going to be taking all the moisture, and you really need to be on top of watering. So ideally, you won't wait until plants are huge before you underplant. You'll plant at an earlier stage, but you will need to be on the ball with regard to irrigation.
Right plant, right place is so important, you know. So maybe in that situation, if it's a birch tree, you know, that you plant underneath with plants that need drier situations, you know, and there's lots of plants that'll take drier situations. But as long as, you have to satisfy your own needs anyway, you know, and whether it's grasses or flowers or just ordinary little, like even heathers, like associated with birches, well, no, it'll remind you of bogland and wild and just native sort of planting schemes.
I mean, I'm just struck by underneath this birch here, you've got the, some people might call it the red hot pokers, the Nymphophaea here, and they're in flower. I mean, they've got a bit of shade there as well, but they're flowering beautifully.
No, I'm amazed what, like, you know, if we go by all the descriptions in books, you know, I think we'd be lost because a lot of them are totally wrong. Because here, like, you know what, there's a royal fern here underneath the birch tree as well. And so that loves moisture, but very happy here underneath the birch. Because I think it all depends on the soil originally anyway, because we're on peaty, wet soil, so it depends on your situation. I can get away with growing this royal fern underneath the birch, but maybe in certain situations I couldn't. We don't have the shelter here for Acers.
Oh, okay.
But we're getting there.
Yeah.
But this is Acer Osakazuki. So I think that this is one of the best for a degree of wind anyway, and because it's very, very happy here. And now we'll look forward to some autumn colour.
Yeah, we get questions into the programme, Seamus, often about Acers, and they're in gardens, maybe they're in exposed locations, and they crisp up, they don't look happy. Yeah. But this one is going to withstand some of that, is it?
No, because it does get a little bit of wind here, you know, but that's like, it might get look a bit tattered at the minute, but it's not too bad. But it will make up for its using the space with this autumn flair now.
So the ones we're really talking about with regard to being tender or who don't like a desiccating wind would be the Japanese maples. So our native one is tough as old boots. You can plant it anywhere, but remember it will self-seed everywhere. The Japanese maples like shelter. They're expensive to buy, so don't be planting them where they're going to be in full wind, because they will not thank you for that. The leaves will just brown up and drop off.
How do they do in a pot? Here, this one is planted in the ground, as Seamus says, seems very happy. What about in a pot?
Japanese maples do particularly well in pots, and I have one in a large pot. It must be there 25 years, and it looks better with each year. So they do like pots. Making sure that the pot is large enough that you've got enough space for a good root ball. Don't expect them to survive in a little tiny pot because they won't have enough moisture. But in large pots, large containers, they will grow particularly well.
Sometimes, David, what I might do is say if I have an Acer or some other plant that I'm not totally familiar with in a windy situation, I might just keep it in the pot in a certain area and see how it does. And if it doesn't do well, at least you don't have to dig it up. You know, you just move it away from that particular area and get it more sheltered. I think that's worthwhile thinking about as well. You know, if you do really like Acers, which they are stunning plants, you know, just experiment if you are fearful that it may not survive.
Yeah, so that's a really practical tip. Then if you buy something, it doesn't need to go into its final resting place.
Who told you that it had to go in right away anyway? Sometimes my plants might stay in pots, you know, for a year or two until I know that they're going to be happy.
Seamus, we are standing beside a plant. I know it's a Cotinus. Which one is it?
Cotinus grace.
And it's looking lovely. Very dark leaves on it. These branches are kind of, you know, they're sprawling out and very, very, very large leaves.
Yeah, well, you'll get the large leaves by pruning in the springtime. So that's what I'll do with this shrub every spring. I'll cut the branches. So I want big leaf. And the main reason is, you see the beautiful tone now, it's just with the light shining through. And it's just drama. If you want a bit of drama in your garden, you know, this is particularly great at providing that. And you can even see the jewels of raindrops on the leaf as well, you know, just sitting there. It's just a stunning plant.
As you say, this time of day, we're getting on towards evening now. The sun isn't really shining today, but even on a day like today, the light is coming through. It's a lovely, warm red colour. And of course, then these leaves in due course, they will colour up for autumn. That's as well. True. But you mentioned earlier about pruning, about cutting back.
Yeah.
I mean, tell us, you know, you can be quite brutal, can't you?
Oh, yeah, cut right down to the stump. And I would do that. There's another plant I would do it a lot with is a Polonia tomentosum. And that's an extraordinary for its foliage because, like, it's the foliage is nearly five times larger than if you just let it to go. The only problem is you're not going to get the flower, you know, but it's not
sometimes
all.
Call it the smoke bush, don't they, because of those flowers.
Yeah, but the flower, yeah. But to me, it's about that this light, you know, the way it affects the colour. It just promotes the colour so much, much more. So, you know, positioning plants is so important as well to catch that low evening light, because it just changes the whole plant, or the beauty of the plant, really. Now, this is the black bamboo Phyllostachys nigra. Absolute gem of a plant, clump forming. So that's been planted for, I'd say, 14...
My goodness.
13 and a half years in there.
So it's well behaved then.
Yeah.
Very well behaved. And what I've done through the years is take the bottom foliage off. So again, that's same as the birch trees, it allows you to see through. And it's just it creates more light at the base as well. So at the base, we have the black mondo grass, which is a black leaf grass, very low growing. So through that in the springtime, we have the snowdrop. So beautiful white flowers and the black, and then that'll be followed. They die off, and that's followed by the anemone, which is a lovely white flower again. So I think it's a gem of a combination to provide more interest, because sometimes, you know, that black grass, it might be hard to get plants. No, it can get lost. So just by combining other plants that can appear and disappear, make it a lot more interesting.
And that grass that you mentioned around the base here, you know, it's quite tight. It's not letting anything else grow there, really. And you mentioned that the snowdrops will come up through that. This bamboo's here, it's a permanent feature as well. Would it be right in saying, Seamus, this would be relatively kind of low maintenance if you didn't want to be the sort of person who's out weeding and out looking after a bit of garden every week?
Yeah, no, totally maintenance-free. I don't think there's any plant that is such a good maintenance-free combination. You know, just ordinary black bamboo and the black mondo grass. No maintenance whatsoever, and you can add things in amongst it. You know, you can plant stuff in through it as well to make it even more appealing. But very, very useful plant for edging or courtyard situations. Very, very useful.
Seamus, we've made our way down into, I think, what you call the exotic garden here, and it's easy to see why, because we have plants surrounding us here which have huge leaves. I know there's the tetrapanax there, the polonia you mentioned earlier, which has been cut back. And, I mean, to give people some idea, I mean, those leaves are, well, they're bigger than dinner plate size, really, aren't they? They're just massive, so dramatic, and giving that exotic feel as well. Some bananas here as well, those big, big leaves. It's a place where you just feel that you're kind of walking into another place, another country, and not that you're necessarily in rural Donegal.
No.
We've seen round so much of the garden, and there's so much to take in. Even since the last time I was here, you know, things constantly changing, evolving, new plants being added, put into new positions. Like, what's next is what I'm tempted to ask. I mean,
well, that's the lovely thing about it, David. It's always going to be a surprise what's next, you know, because there's so many plants.
But that's an exciting thing, isn't it, at this time of year, and as we kind of creep out of autumn and into winter, to think about the future, to think about the future plans. It's lovely, isn't it?
Well, it's a very healthy attitude, I think. You know, you're thinking ahead all the time, you know, and it's a positive attitude. And so, you know, I think that's a very healthy way to look at life.
Brendan, what's your takeaway from today? Because I know it had been a while since you'd been down to Clearing the Door, and you've had a walk around, and you've just been constantly saying to me, you know, wow, you know, this collection, you know, it's just amazing. What's your takeaway?
Wow, it's difficult to kind of put into words.
Well, you're going to have to.
Yeah, okay. I think coming back to Clearing the Door is as good as the tonic. And I think the thing that strikes me now is that this is a garden you need to walk through very slowly. This is not for a whistle-stop tour. Don't come here if you are in a hurry, if you don't have the time or the patience to enjoy the space. But if you do have the time and the patience, it is the most rewarding experience. I would have to say this tour with Seamus around the garden has been as good as a tonic. It has relaxed me. He has a wonderful collection of plants, a stunning collection. He says some areas are not doing it for him. Well, he certainly didn't show us any areas that weren't doing it. Everywhere we looked, it was just ooh. But we have finished in the exotic garden, standing on this lovely paved area, surrounded by a jungle of foliage and flower types and shapes and growth habits. It is a stunning place. Well worth a visit. And the exotic garden, if you were to do nothing else, the exotic garden is the place to come to. It is heaven on earth.
Gardener's Corner with David Maxwell. Let's grow together.
Well, Brendan, what a day out, getting to see two beautiful gardens, two very different places. And of course, the wonderful thing about visiting other gardens is there's always something to learn and something you can bring home.
Always. Today was like a tonic for me to go out and visit gardens. And yes, there are always cameos that you can see. And you say, yeah, I could replicate that to a degree in my own space. So, you know, you can visit gardens like Clearing the Door and Glenveagh and come home intimidated. Or you can say, yeah, just take photographs of the little cameos that you could replicate in your space. We don't all have those kind of grandiose areas, that large space to work with. But as I say, with your eyes open, there will be little small aspects, little small treats that you can bring and use in your own garden.
So nice to be back in yours as well. We're back in the courtyard where we began our day. And I thought, Brendan, we'd put you to hard work this week and we'd put a few questions to you because, you know, you might be rusty, you might be out of practice. So there's questions in the Gardener's Corner mailbag. If you ever have one, of course, you can send it to gardenerscorner@bbc.co.uk. Let's pick up this one. The first one doesn't have a name. It's, can sempervivum be grown outside? What is sempervivum, first of all?
Oh, yeah, the house leek. And they are the most beautiful plants. And of course, you can grow them out of doors. They are fully hardy. They don't like wet feet. So put them in a nice, gritty soil. They are lovely in pots. They will hug the edge of the pot and soften that edge. Of course, house leeks traditionally were grown on the roofs of houses. They would grow between the slates. And they would also help to hold the roof together. So they had that binding that kept the roof intact. And they, you see these lovely photographs of these lovely old houses, cottages with house leeks running through the roof, and they are great. But yes, to answer the question, they grow very well out of doors. They don't want wet feet. A nice, free-draining, gritty compost is exactly what they crave.
Frances has been in touch from Bangor. She says that she has a fatsia and there are black spots on the leaves that look like cigarette burns. She said she's looked them up on the internet. It suggests it could be to do with watering from above. She's really not sure. She's wondering what they are. Is it possibly to do with her being near the sea air? She lives down by the coast. What's the problem? Is it anything to worry about?
Okay, the plant we're talking about is an outdoor plant, not to be confused with the indoor fatsia. The one we're talking about is Fatsia japonica, a big palmate leaf, a glorious architectural plant which I grow, which a lot of folk grow. It's a lovely plant. You would grow it if it never flowered. Now, it's a good coastal garden plant and it likes lots of air circulation. And the black spots are very much a sign of a fungal disease. So your fatsia may be kind of tucked in and is not getting that air circulation. Fungal infections, fungal diseases, like claustrophobic spaces where you don't have air circulation. So maybe a little bit of pruning around to allow more air to get to your fatsia could solve the problem. But it's a fungal disease. It's nothing to do with the watering of the plant because they grow very well out of doors. You couldn't be restricting yourself to watering an outdoor plant at the base only because the good Lord is going to water it from above anyway. So you can't get around that. But it's a fungal disease. Air circulation is always the enemy of fungal infection.
I'm going hard on you here. I'm keeping the questions going, Brendan. Vivian has been in touch. She says she has a bottle brush shrub which has become rather straggly and unkempt. Can you advise her on the best way and time to prune it?
Yeah, the Calstemon's a lovely range of plants and quite aptly called the bottle brush plants. That's exactly what they look like. Now, I wouldn't be inclined to cut it to the ground, but what I would like to do is to take a couple of the older shoots out, leaving a few, and new shoots will come from the base. And then in a year or two, you can take out the ones that you left in. So don't be too drastic with it. Don't cut it to the ground. Take out a number of the old shoots. New shoots will appear. And then follow on by taking out the ones that you didn't take out at the first pruning a couple of years down the road.
Both Heather and Norman have been in touch separately this week about that old issue of when to prune hydrangeas. Do you leave the flowers on? Do you leave them to die back over the winter? Do you cut them off now because maybe they begin to look a bit unsightly? What is the right or the wrong thing to do?
I think it's very important before you prune any plant that you know a little bit about the plant, because there are various types of hydrangeas. There's the big one, Hydrangea aspera. There's paniculata types. But I think the one you're probably referring to is Hortensiana types, the mop heads or the lace caps. They produce the flower buds this year that will carry the flowers next year. So if you get a very harsh winter, those flower buds could be damaged and they won't flower as well next year. So I would always prune them in spring.
Last question, I promise. This is from John and it's a question about his lawn. Of course, a lot of people thinking about lawns at this time of year and maybe just looking after them a little bit before we get into autumn proper and on into winter as well. John has sent through some photographs to gardenerscorner@bbc.co.uk, which you have had a look at. He said at first he thought that these kind of brown spots on the lawn might have been caused by a neighbourhood cat, but then he thought, well, actually, they are very, very widespread. I think unless the cat has an issue, it probably isn't the cat. and he's wondering what it could be. This lawn was re-led 3 years ago using rolled turf, so a fair bit invested probably in putting the lawn down. But yeah, these brown patches are appearing. It looks a little bit unsightly. What do you think?
It seems to be a problem I find sometimes with rolled out lawns, that because they have been rolled up, fungal diseases tend to, if they are present at all, will proliferate. And when you roll out the lawn, the fungal disease is still there. And we're looking at Fusarium, which is a fungus. And Irem may have been on the grass before you rolled it out, but Fusarium is a problem, certainly on golf courses where there's a lot of manicured lawns, particularly on golf greens where the grass is constantly stressed. How you get around it is you could spray with a fungicide. You need to feed the lawn and you need to have a good strict mowing regime. Don't be inclined to cut the grass too low. Don't let it grow too high. So I think it would just smarten up maybe on the mowing regime. I would feed it next spring, but don't overfeed it or it becomes a little bit too soft. But it is a fungal infection. You will find various products on the market that will solve your issue.
Brendan, thank you very much indeed. You'll be glad to hear that you're out of the hot seat. Well, until next week anyway, because we should say that next week Gardener's Corner will be coming live from the Balmoral Show. And it's your chance to come along, get there early on Saturday morning, and you can have a seat to watch Gardener's Corner. And I can promise you that our very special guest, Brendan Little, will also be joining us to take your questions live. So do join us for that at the Balmoral Show next week, when we'll also be bringing you some highlights from the Chelsea Flower Show, which of course gets underway on Monday. If you missed anything on the programme this week, of course you can listen again on BBC Sounds, and that is the best place to go to if you want to pick up some of those plant names. And of course you can always get in touch with us. That email address, one more time, gardenerscorner@bbc.co.uk. But for now, from me, David Maxwell, from Brendan Little and from producer Nicola Weir, thanks for listening and enjoy your garden.
This is a download for the BBC, and for our terms and conditions, go to bbc.co.uk/podcasts.